I must, when Shyamji asked me, will you be making a PowerPoint presentation, I'm extremely uneasy about PowerPoints, because I think, unfortunately, we'll stop focusing on, there's neither power nor points in this PowerPoint usually, and I told him that I'll try to make powerful points, and hopefully leave behind some thoughts of mine. I'm not saying these are the only valid thoughts, this is one way of looking at it. Most of my work is born out of living and working for more than 3 decades. My life began with indigenous tribal communities in Karnataka, and now we work across a lot of sectors. So I'm going to draw upon my experience of just living with people, and especially people for whom sustainability is a way of life and not a slogan that we have made it into today. So I'm very deeply concerned with this fashion statement SDG. I've been part of the committees of the UN earlier to look at all that. And I would like to start off raising a few issues and trying to trace a little history. How did this idea of development come in, first of all? Why did the people join the word sustainable to it suddenly? And the trajectory of the way the global narrative has emerged from all this. And how is it relevant to a country like India? And what is it that we can possibly learn from this process, or at least learn to undo what they have already done? I would put it that way. You know, the global narrative of human development, unfortunately, till the 60s or 70s, like all of us in this room would know, and I think it continues even today, despite the slogans, has been around economic growth, income growth, and GDPs. Even today, we celebrate GDP. You know, we celebrate more when the ease of doing business is reported, and we don't talk when the human capital index is released. So they are all different versions of what we look at, what is convenient to us and what we interpret and understand from human development. What has this growth really resulted in? And if you look at, I think some many years ago, I'm not sure which year, again, one of the UN organizations or OECD, I'm not sure which one, had a global conference trying to look at how human beings and their efforts in whatever, you call it development, growth, whatever, how is change happening around the world? And we'll all be surprised that when this was happening in early 2000, maybe just after the millennium, the amount of change that had happened from assuming that post-Christ is a milestone in the Western narrative. So from 0 AD or 1 AD to 1900, the amount of change that cumulatively happened by human progress and development for 1900 years was substantially lesser than the change that happened between 1901 and 1999. And the change that happened between 1999 and 2000 was far higher than that happened in the previous 99 years.
very rarely, but I've written about it also. A very painful experience for me, the way I understood human development. I was a very young doctor, 21, 22 years old. I thought I can change the world. I'll be the next Albert Schweitzer. Everything will happen. India will become very different if I go work in a village for 5 years. Went into this tribal area, and in our tribal areas, the colony is named after the chieftain. So Sani Madaya was a chieftain. So Sani Madana Hadi was his particular colony of 5 houses. They lived in the forest, all these Kadukur, they were Kadukurba tribals. They had access to 160 different kinds of greens. Possibly the only green we'll know is palak and something else, but they knew 160 different kinds. They had access to all the protein they wanted in the forest. Anytime you felt hungry, go kill a deer or a wild boar and you have all your protein. 38 different kinds of tubers was part of their diet. And then in the name of development, we came and built dams. We declared the forest national park, threw them out of the forest and said, you can't access any of this. And then we said, we have a name for you. Sewa is in the same place, not just one. Suffered the trauma of 2 national parks being formed, no rehabilitation of any sort. They were not even national parks by law, but they were already called national parks. And when I went in there, I thought I can change all this. 30 years after all the damage, that's a naivety of a 22-year-old. And I heard, and the tribals never bothered about my presence. They thought I was a glorified nuisance for them, because they didn't know what to do with me, so they tolerated me. But I wanted to be seen as a doctor. And one day I heard Madi was pregnant. And I thought, oh, this is a great opportunity. And luckily for me, Madi was a daughter of Sani Madaya, the chieftain. So I thought, if I deliver the chieftain's daughter, all the chieftains will accept me. Now I'll be a hero. And then I'll be God for them. So my intent was not whether Madi had to deliver safely. My intent was I have to be accepted now. And my affirmation that comes from practicing medicine there. So I went to Madi's house around 6:30 in the evening. And then I realized she was a 14-year-old. Very disappointed. Why can't this baby follow a textbook and just come the way it should have come? I still thought I should go there and prove I'm a doctor. I was fortunate to study under an extraordinary gynecologist, Dr. Kaulgur. He had told me nicely, he said, if you want to, I loved obstetrics those days. So he said, if you want to be an obstetrician, you must learn to practice watchful expectancy. He said, do nothing, nature will do everything. And so I thought nature is possibly done before what I could do anything. So it's in a hurry. So I went there, I thought, let me put some eye drops to the eye, some tension violet to the umbilical stump. And I'm standing at the hut of Madi outside, and tribal culture demanded that I must take the permission of the Yajamana before going into the colony and permission of the lady of the house before I enter the house. I'm standing at the door of this hut asking Madi to come out and show me the baby. 5 minutes of negotiation, nothing happened. 10 minutes of negotiation, nothing happened. Finally, I started getting angry. I'm a university ranker and I've given up so much of a career. I come here, this girl doesn't even come out when I call her. So I started getting angrier and angrier. 14. So what should, why, how will she not get pregnant? Maybe she goes to school. So I built hospitals, I built schools, I built all that, and 20 years later, fast forwarding it, nothing much had changed. Patients keep coming to my hospital, patients keep falling sick, I keep treating them, they go back and they fall sick again. So I ran schools, built colleges, that's all happened. I kept building institutions and more buildings. But did human development happen? I was not sure I had an answer to that. I was still troubled. Because why did they become poor in the first place? Why didn't we allow them to live in the forest? Why were they brought out of the forest? Why was the state causing poverty in them and then causing rehabilitation? So these questions troubled me so much. I sued the government. I sued the government of India, government of Karnataka. I was beaten up, I was arrested. I had fun. But the bottom line is, tribals didn't actually, they were more developed in the forest than they were outside. Now in the crossroad, they were caught in. So in search of answers, I thought maybe Harvard will have answers when they spend time. Realized that possibly they have less answers, but at least what they gave me was different ways of asking questions. I started exploring deep and asking difficult questions and started looking at data, looking at evidence, looking at why are we poor? Why are we poor for a long time? Why is income, why does it even matter? That is when this narrative of Millennium Development Goals started, and then sometimes we in the civil society sector become cosmetic participants in United Nations meetings. And so to tick off a box saying we have consulted civil society, we are all invited and we form subcommittees and then we are part of all this that happens. So I realized that there is a lot of discussion going around the world, but very few people were talking about the problems that development that we have been speaking about for 50, 60 years has actually caused. So I believe that the three major crises we have created, and if our development interventions today cannot resolve those crises, there are two things we have to do. First, not create the crisis anymore, not fan the crisis further, at the same time stop the crisis. The first crisis, I think, is we have created a crisis of unprecedented dimensions, the ecological crisis. ...73% of India's wealth. I have nothing against that 1%, but my concern is the remaining 99%. If you break it down further, the top 20% of India, they generate and control close to 85% of India's wealth. The bottom 20%, for whom all of us in this room are very concerned, they are able to control and generate 1.5% of India's wealth. The so-called great Indian middle class is somewhere in between 13.5%. The bottom 1.5% is increasingly seen as consumers of at the bottom of the pyramid, rather than participants in wealth creation. Even in the wealth creating narrative, they are not part of the story. The story is always somebody else on the top. So the GDP story is so skewed that we have created an enormously inequitable society. Whether it is digital inequity, whether it is academic inequities, whether it is societal inequities, social class inequities or caste inequities, we have created all this around the world, not just here. Look at the kind of political inequities and narratives the world is fashioning today. What kind of stories we create around the world. It's horrendous to even read the newspapers now. The third inequity, which I think is where India has got a huge opportunity. To ourselves today. We don't even spend time to understand who are we, what are we doing. And this enormous self-crisis, in a very academic language, if I were to say, just imagine 1.5 million people commit suicide every year, and most of them are the age group of 20 to 30. So possibly the world's greatest assets, not just India, everywhere the story is the same. Just losing connection with their own self, the inability to manage themselves and what is going wrong. So can sustainable development goals address all these three crises? If not, it is neither development nor sustainable. And why is it not sustainable? Let me explain the 17 goals. Again, revolves around, now they brought in a lot more. They're not just poverty, education, healthcare. If MDG spoke of HIV, AIDS and mother and child health, now we're a little more expansive now. But I would like to shift gear now and talk about what is it that India can offer to this thinking. What did India have? Why is it that's important that India can truly be the Jagatguru? And without romanticizing, I'm saying this. And what is it that we can learn? And I would like you all to possibly, many of you might already have done work in this field or read these reports, Angus Maddison's.
Even by the economic measurements that the world has presented for 1600 years. What changed between two civilizations? And we need to learn from the other civilization to whatever their political narrative is. The Chinese and Indian civilization together, if they could capture more than 2/3 of the world's GDP growth, there's some secret there which we need to understand. What is it that we're missing today? And what are the lessons we can learn? Are these lessons tied somewhere to the real indigenous native intelligence that existed in India, and can we offer it to the world in a way in which it's practical, it's prudent, and it's necessary? It's not just a romantic story that we offer. So my belief is India's growth story was successful not because we focus on the economic growth at all. It was incidental. Economic growth happened not because we focused on it. It happened as a consequence of something else that we focused on. And that is the fascinating contribution India can give to the world. We focused on building human and social capital. Look at the kind of stories that India has got. Look at the kind of, you can call them Puranas, you can call them stories, you can call them. Capital, because building that has got enormously powerful economic consequences. What is that human potential? What is the human capital that we're talking about? Human capital, to me, in a very simplistic way, you know, people define it in so many ways. The World Bank recently, you know, I was happy that 4 years ago, I was challenged by the economists of the World Bank, and I was invited to make my presentation of what I believe is this Indic version there. Surprisingly, they actually tolerated me. You know, talking in the lion's den, challenging the economic narratives and telling them that possibly that's inadequate. I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm not even saying economic capital is not important. All I'm saying is that is not, cannot and should not be the end. It happens. It's not what we're all working for. And today, the first time in the world, the Human Capital Index report has been released by the World Bank 3-4 months ago. I still think it's inadequate. I still think my argument is it's not complete. It doesn't capture all the narratives that I'm trying to put across. It is a very predictive, futuristic thinking. 18 years later, how would the child be, and what kind of economic development? understanding physical, look at the contribution, look at yogasana. The recent Harvard Medical School report says the best conceived medical exercise of the human body is yogasana. And we celebrate International Yoga Day and we talk about it. It's become a $30 billion industry in America. But will every child in every Indian school practice yogasana? It's simple physical, the physical growth of the human body was so well thought about through yoga. The cognitive attainment, look at the Gurukula system. We were the only nation which had fashioned an education system driven by both repetitive thinking and reflective thinking. You have to memorize your Subhashitas and all your slokas and talk about it, but then you reflect on it also. Today, reflective thinking has become a gap in our entire approach to education. And India had that. We were both, and today we understand we need repetitive thinking and reflective thinking. When Howard Gardner writes of multiple intelligence theory, we celebrate him by his books. Indian Gurukula system was focusing only on multiple intelligences. Why are we not even looking at it? So this was the teaching and making money. Why did I choose to go live in a forest? Asking existential questions, the fundamental questions revolving around the spirit of self-inquiry is the greatest contribution India gave for spirituality, and we have forgotten that. So human capital is building it in these four domains. Social capital is simplistically the benefits we acquire by transacting the social networks that we belong. Look at the power of people sitting in this room. Across 12 or 13 countries today, we are represented here. We carry this powerful ideology of development to these countries. Look at the social capital that exists here in this room. Srinathji was discussing with me 2 days ago about intervention in Kodugu. He has nothing to do with Kodugu. But why is he concerned? What is that in him that prompts him to think about the people of Kodugu and say, I should do something after the floods? What are the kind of social capital the people of Kodugu know benefit by that? So we don't even consider these questions, and I believe now sustainable development can happen only when we fashion the statement of building human and social capital, which is actually went to Supreme Court saying the RTE violates the rights of the rich. Many of you might not even be aware of it. They said that if 25% of children are coming from poor neighborhoods and they're sitting with the rich children, the right of the rich child is affected by it. Thankfully, the court threw it out. But they actually appealed, saying that how can you fundamentally ignore this right of the rich child? A country where equity, where Krishna and Sudama could be together. It's not just a story. I think it's a powerful message for all of us. So I believe, unless we go back and change this development narrative, and we start talking all this to the rest of the world, and these things are happening. I'm actually, part of my work the last 5 to 7 years is to develop indicators to measure all this, both specific and sensitive indicators. How does human capital expand? How do you capture it? How does it reflect in our programs? how programs can be designed based on this. I run workshops exclusively trying to tell people how to do it. I teach courses based only on this. Luckily, thankfully now, whether it's Cornell or IIT Delhi, we are spent 1 year with me in Mysore. Today, she's the Minister of Social Development in our country, and we are running a massive nationwide program in that country. And I can tell you, these things work. This is not just emotions. And that is why I'm in a hurry now, because the urgency is because these things actually work. And we don't have the time, the world doesn't have the time for us to just talk. We have to actually go do it. I'm running similar experiments in another country where I'm advisor, and we're seeing fascinating results. And I think the time has come for us here in these experiments, recapture that powerful narrative, presents it in a language which is translatable to the Western audience, tells them that narratives don't have to come from their nations. Definitions of SDG doesn't have to come from New York. It can come from Delhi or India or Bangalore or from a village in Karnataka. And if we can fashion these statements, present to them as workable, implementable experiments, and measurable outcomes are clearly demonstrated, we can actually make the SDG real SDGs. So development will be sustainable. Who around the world are doing various experiments, I would only request you to pause and reflect and ask yourself, every activity that you do, how are you building human capital? In what domain are you building it? Every activity that you do, don't call it just microcredit, which is a Western narrative again. Call it the collectivization that India was known for, the building of social capital that we were known for. And microcredit gives it an economic focus. Social collectivization gives it a social capital focus. And that will result in so many other consequences. So there's so many ways we can reinterpret the work we are doing, redefine it, refashion this, and that will be the message that the Jagat Guru called India can give to the world. And then we can look forward to a world which is truly sustainable. Thank you.